Doctor Who, Dead on Arrival and Other Stories by Paul Mars. Adapted from illustrated strips in World Distributors' Doctor Who Annuals. Dead on Arrival, from the Doctor Who Annual, 1975. Read by Katy Manning. Many strange things had happened to Jo Grant during her adventures with Doctor Who. Recently, with the TARDIS now fully operational again, their exploits together had taken an even more outlandish turn. It had all begun with a visit to the colourful world of Meslob, where gravity was 27 times greater than that of Earth, and most of the planet was ruled by a race of gigantic, peace-loving snails. In order to attend the ambassador's ball, at which Jo looked forward to her first ever dance with a mollusk, the travellers had to alter their molecular density so as to avoid being squashed flat in front of everybody. Jo had agreed readily and had stepped inside a glass, bell jar-like cubicle that stood in a corner of the TARDIS control room. Somehow, she had never noticed it there before. The Doctor had operated a complex bank of controls, and then, after Jo had stepped out, he had taken his own turn at having his bodily density altered. Never, on any of their previous adventures, had such preparations been necessary. But Jo had guessed that the gravity of Meslob must be particularly tricky. Anyway, it had all been worth it for the ball. It had been quite strange, to say the least, dancing with all those snails and on a floor that quickly became quite sticky. But all in all, it had been a lovely party. Now, before their return to Earth, it was time to turn their molecular density back to normal. And so Jo found herself inside the machine again. The Doctor's scientific reasoning was tip-top as usual, but his timing could have been better. Unbeknownst to him, at the very moment he was manipulating the molecular adjuster, the TARDIS was drifting into a cloud of livid cosmic dust. The Doctor was too caught up in the delicate operation to notice his ship's police box shell being surrounded by this pulsating orange miasma. The bright lighting inside the ship flickered, as if trying to warn the travellers that something was amiss. Then there came a hideous crackling noise and a sharp smell of burning circuitry. Strange, the Doctor thought, as the dials before him flickered and dithered. There seems to be a malfunction. Inside the cubicle, Jo realized that something was wrong and felt a flutter of panic in her throat. All at once, she felt claustrophobic, trapped inside the distorting glass. Doctor Who became exasperated as he flipped switches and eyed the readings on the console before him. I'd better put the power on ultra boost, he muttered decisively. In retrospect, much later, he would reflect that this had been a mistake. The interior of the timeship flared with sudden lurid colour, and smoke started to pour out of the molecular adjuster cubicle. The Doctor's eyes widened in shock. He whirled around, helpless to do anything at all. He stared in appalled dismay as his young companion crumpled and fell, sliding helplessly to the floor of the bell jar. He darted forward.
Jar?
But it was already too late. Jo realized that she was still alive, but she felt quite peculiar and not her usual self. When eventually she sat up, she found she was back on Earth and sitting on soft green grass. All around her were bushes and trees. It looked like a park of some kind. Jo could hear children playing and the distant noise of city traffic. She felt woozy and strange, as if somehow she wasn't quite in sync with the world. The last thing she could remember was standing inside that glass jar aboard the TARDIS, and all the noise and light. Suddenly, she came to her senses. The Doctor? Where was he? What's more, where was the TARDIS? How had she come to be here on Earth alone? Jo stood up very carefully. She didn't seem to be injured in any way, but she did feel weirdly light on her feet and somehow insubstantial. When she held her hands up in front of her face, there was a queer kind of shimmering around them and a crackling light. In fact, she realized her whole body was suffused by a strange, unearthly glow. Oh, Doctor, what have you gone and done this time? Her frantic train of thought was interrupted by voices nearby. They weren't the happy cries and yells of ordinary, everyday people enjoying themselves in the park. These were high-fluting voices coming from somewhere nearby, voices that made the hair stand up on the back of her neck as she pressed through the bushes to get closer.
"These people are soft and fluffy,"
one of them observed.
"They will be easily subdued."
Jo held her breath and eased quietly through the branches until she could see who was talking. Two startling-looking reptilian beings were crouched in the undergrowth, spying on the unwary parkgoers. Both aliens had fleshy green ears and vicious-looking claws, and they wore sturdy metallic space armor. With a jolt of surprise, Jo saw that they also had that same nimbus of crackling energy around their bodies. The second of the reptilian aliens looked extremely supercilious.
"We're humans are finished," he sneered. "Once that materializer gets here..."
Jo didn't know who they were or what they intended. She had no idea what a materializer was, but she was quite sure these noxious beings were up to no good. Somehow she had been made privy to their plans, and she realized that she had to make good use of that knowledge. She instinctively knew what to do. "I must warn the Doctor." On leaving the park, she realized that she wasn't actually all that far from Unit HQ.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.